Okay, so I am going to just give a brief welcome to everybody and talk a little bit, very little bit, about Claudia and Betsy. I think most of you know them. If you don't, you're soon going to. They are a team. They do governance for AAUW Oregon, and they have taken on AAUW Funds. They are both former AAUW National Board members. They've been involved with the organization for a long time at various levels, and they are charming and delightful and extremely knowledgeable. So with that very serious introduction aside, take it away, ladies.
Pat sent a preview to us and I said, wow, you made us sound important.
Thank you, Pat.
Thank you. It's been interesting because people have not been quite sure what to do. Fortunately, some of you were branch president or branch funds chairs when Betsy and I took over. We didn't take over till October. So you, in some cases, knew more than we did. And some of the first things I sent out, I said to you, it's changed a lot since I was the state funds chair 6 years ago. And so I'm relying on you to help me with some of that. I really appreciate that from all of you. Betsy, did you want to start with your pop-up?
I do. Nancy, did you get that document? Nancy Brown?
There.
Okay. And
go ahead, Betsy.
Well, there's a document on the funds diagram is what I was after. If you can scroll down, Nancy. This was based on, let's see if it'll show up here. It was based on the strategic plan. The AAUW National Strategic Plan was kind of overhauled in 2014 to 2018. And they narrowed it down to four focus areas: education and training, economic security, leadership, and the fourth one is governance and sustainability. So we have developed this slimmed down catalog of AAUW funds to donate to. And the reason I wanted to go over this specifically is that we have such a gorgeous, rich legacy of contributions from Oregon. And if any of you, you know, have been donors in the past, you can relate to terms like Eleanor Roosevelt Fund and teaching fellowships. But when you look at these four sections, I think this is close. This is fine if you want to leave it here, Nancy. Thank you. That's not on the menu anymore. So this has been rearranged because the classic old educational foundation is fully funded at over $100 million. If none of us ever contribute to that, what has been renamed section again, it would continue to roll out $4 to $5 million a year in grants and fellowships. And that number stays at that range because it's the 4% coming off of that endowment, but also that endowment has a lot of restrictions on it. So if you look at this education and training fund, number 445, it's kind of taking the place of what we old timers or long timers knew as the educational foundation, okay? And so it talks, you know, it is women, you know, we know that there are more women on campus than men now. Mission accomplished, yay. It only took 120 years. It deals with scholarships, fellowships, and research. And then the main part of it, though, is to try to eliminate discrimination in the workplace and on campus. The next one, the Leadership Fund. So that's kind of us as college students. Then the Leadership Fund is trying to engage us as leaders in boards and in the workplace. And again, kind of preventing the bias and barriers to our success, to fight against those. And the third one, Economic Security Fund 4449, Workplace Employer Bias, Equity Laws, Legal Advocacy Fund, and the Addressing the Pay Gap. So the piece that's not on this page, and that's the fourth fund, it's called the Greatest Need Fund. And maybe Marty Stevens knows why it was numbered but it'll stand out in my mind forever because it's 9110, like emergency 9110. It's going to be our big bucket. It's where we can be more nimble in the projects that we assign our monies to. As you've understood, probably as you've gotten more publications from AAUW National, this is where we can do more on-the-spot research, immediate action advocacy, such as the Me Too movement and our legislative work, which used to be called the Action Fund. Do anybody have any questions so far?
I would add one comment to that. The other part of the greatest need is it finishes off. They use some of that to finish off other sections that we used to have specifically things for, as I was told, that if Eleanor Roosevelt needs more funds this year, they can put some of that in there. Is that still true, Betsy?
That goes into the education and
it
training
doesn't go,
fund.
It doesn't go to Eleanor at all?
That 4450 would go to Eleanor Roosevelt.
Right.
Eleanor Roosevelt's overflowing.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Ah, see, I'm 4 years at least out of date on this stuff.
Yeah.
From what, well, it's been longer than that since, yeah, that's 4 years since Mark.
Mm-hmm. Okay. It is self-sustaining. It's quite, you know, when you think about those numbers and the number of us in this organization.
Who still support them.
Yeah, it's phenomenal what we've accomplished very slowly over the years. And it's kind of that old adage.
Thank you.
Don't underestimate us. We get stuff done.
I wish they would tell us that sort of thing specifically. Maybe I need to ask directly. Pat has a question.
So does Margaret.
So does greatest needs include operations?
Yes, I believe it does.
Thank you.
Marty may know that.
And operations is huge. Greatest needs doesn't pay salaries, okay?
Okay, good. Thank you.
Yeah, but yeah. It would... It could be something like a targeted project, or we don't do a ton by mail outside of our member contact, but you can even tell that's much diminished. But yes, greatest needs can go into the operational fund and be affected by board and CEO directives.
Okay, thanks.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
My turn?
Yes.
No. Do we have any say on what 9110 funds?
Once you send it into that funnel, not really, no. I think if you accompanied your donation, if it was sizable and you accompanied it with a directive, that would certainly be under consideration, because one of the biggest things that has become Kim is a fundraising guru. She knows all about donor intent and how to keep people happy. And that's really one of her primary goals. When she was at Brookings, she set all kinds of records for fundraising. So if you said, hey, I want to give to the 9110, but here's what I've got in my mind, I do think it's a conversation worth having with her.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Betsy, question. Those of us who are long-term LIF supporters, mm-hmm. are you saying the Economic Security Fund is where that money should go?
Mm-hmm. Yes, okay. And you could put that in your memo line. Isn't it awkward? Doesn't it feel funny?
It does.
Yeah.
So Susan Shea has a question. Can you still donate to the old funds like Eleanor Roosevelt?
Yes.
You can. You can put it in your memo line.
And I will say that I've been getting lots of CRFs, the contribution report forms, in the last 2 weeks, and people have been very specific to the point where I had to call, bless her heart, Mary Wright Gillespie, and say, is this an endowment? Because it's not a number I'm familiar with. And it was. She might mm-hmm. mention that.
Mm-hmm.
Mary, are you willing to speak to that for a minute? I can't see Mary, so I don't know.
And Pat Lehman is saying, is LAF filled and self-sustaining? It is at the level that they're using it right now. it doesn't have as high an endowment. It doesn't, it isn't at that 100 million level like the education and fund and training fund is, but it is for the purposes, the number of cases they're using, it is self-sustaining right now.
Okay. Claudia, can you hear me?
Yes. Yes. Okay. Thank you, Mary.
The thing that's, I find it's challenging right now is that a lot of our members who have given loyally over the years, yes, still want to support those funds that they've been giving to.
Exactly.
And like we have two funds that came out of our branch, and there are several people that want to continue to give to that. I don't think they'll change their minds. So, I mean, I don't know. Am I supposed to educate them?
Mary and I have talked about this a bit in emails, and then I called her the other night because I wasn't quite sure about this number that she sent in. And as I said, it's an endowment, and it's endowment that was started in Humboldt, California, while ago, because it's a 1700 number. A couple of her members have transferred in from California. Their branch started this endowment. It's complete now, as is their Kenneth McGraw Memorial Endowment. But there are still people who want to contribute to those. And I've said to her, don't discourage them. I mean, the biggest part of giving is what the donor intent is, what the donor wants. And if that's where they want to give it, please encourage them to give it there.
Okay. Okay. Great.
And I asked Mary specifically if she would be on this call because she was also the funds branch funds chair when I was the state chair for 4 years. And I was always impressed with the CRF that she sent in because she does so well with fundraisers in her branch. But this year I was particularly impressed because despite COVID and despite our being locked down and not being able to have events, she sends in a donation every single month from one or more of her members. And I wanted to know how she did that. How do you do that, Mary, especially now? I mean, I have CRFs from you for June, July, August, September, October. It's amazing. How do you do it?
Well, I can't take credit for it. People are just, it's habit, I think. I mean, I used to, when we met, I always had envelopes and a list that our branch liked to contribute to, so to make it as easy as possible. This year, I think we're about half of what we usually give, and we don't, because we don't have a fundraiser. So I'm glad that you're impressed. I didn't feel that way. We are going to try something new for 2021 in that, I don't know if the rest of you do phantom tea parties, but that has always been for our local colleges, Rogue Community College and Southern Oregon University. This, in the new year, we're also going to have a line that they could give to AAUW funds and to the education fund. So we'll see. I don't know whether people will respond to that, but we want to try something new because we don't have our usual fundraiser.
Thank you. Thank you. That's good to know. I'll watch out for that.
And did you say you are doing a phantom tea party?
Yes. They do. Okay. We do it January through March, but always in the past, all the money has gone locally. That has not been a national.
They run two local scholarships through their college foundation. And that's most of our branches, at least all the ones I know about that have a local scholarship, are running it through the college foundation unless they are incorporated themselves and can do it themselves.
I'm sorry, what is Mary's branch?
Medford.
That's what I thought. Okay.
Maybe that's what we should do. I should ask you if you say something to at least tell us what branch you're from. We can see your names, but not the branch. And Pat has a question.
I do. And this sounds like a very naive question, but I'm still a little unclear about this. Where do funds like the Margaret Drummond Fund and the Claudia Gray Fund and others that are local or state sponsored, where do they fit in with the big picture with national? Or do they?
Do you remember Betsy saying that the endowments are at 100 million now? And people have been concerned about the number of branches that have been disbanding, and is AAUW going to be around in 20 years? When Sue Barley came to speak at our branch, she was on the national board then. Betsy, you know Sue. Mm-hmm. She said they were disbanding 50 branches a year. And I said, we have a few people who are concerned about that. But what I say is those endowments are chiseled in stone. There will always be an office with a fiduciary responsibility for that $100 million in endowments.
And that's where they are. They're in what they was the Educational Foundation, which has since been
the IRS made it break up. Yeah, the IRS said we couldn't have a board for AAUW and a board for the Educational Foundation. That was right after I was on the board.
Right, but that financial instrument right. still exists intact with yes. all of our endowments in it.
So there's an endowment for Betsy, an endowment for me, there's an endowment for Margaret. I'm looking at see who else is here. We have 19 named endowments completed, all completed in Oregon. National is discouraging any new endowments. The last time I asked, the figure was double what it had been before, and the timeline was about a third of what it had been, which is a huge burden. And as far as I know, I don't think anybody started an endowment probably in the last 4 years at least.
And part of the reason for that is that you can't just dip right. into it and spend it. You have to follow all the strictures, all of the applications and IRS rulings that have been, that were the founding documents for what was the Educational Foundation at the time.
And some of them are very specific. Most mm-hmm. of ours are research and projects, which mm-hmm. is the most common category. And at the time, frankly, was the least amount of money that we had to come up with. Pendleton's is a career development. So when you look at that, is that going to go in with the research and projects? But I will send tomorrow what I sent to Jill today, which is the endowment list for Oregon by branch. And I believe it was in my first or second email to all the branch chairs. Mm-hmm. But I keep reminding you all because we did really, really good work for many, many years. And when I finished up my term as state funds chair, my goal in those last 2 years was to complete all the endowments that had been left open. One of them had been left open for 20 years. They'd simply forgotten about it. Mm-hmm. So what I did was ask the branches, if you're not committed to another particular category, would you consider, it's how we finished Pendleton's, would you please consider donating your branch funds to Pendleton's so we can finish their endowment? And then we took the state money that was going in and put it in the Pendleton one to polish them off. So when I retired, all of them were finished.
And this Margaret has a question.
Betsy's got a comment right here. What?
Yeah, just want to see if I can get that. This is a one pager that Claudia sent out early in the year.
Yeah.
And each of the funds, that's greatest need in education, economic security, and leadership. Have you guys all seen those thought bubbles where the circles larger, smaller, et cetera? You could almost reimagine this document. Anyway, please look for it in your inbox from Claudia early on. Why am I looking at the camera around the picture? I don't know. Anyway.
the glory of that particular little poster is that underneath it lists some of the things that are in that category,
yeah.
like
yeah.
Start Smart, that sort of thing, which gives you, at the bottom.
The biggest thing that it illustrated to me is how this thing all intersects with research. We've got research and leadership. We have research and economic security. We have research and education and training, and we have greatest need research. And so for those of us who have a really soft spot in our heart for AAUW research and how it generates interest in our organization, give freely to all four. It all happens through those four categories, okay?
And Margaret Drummond had a question.
Yeah, you said that EF was separate from AAUW. Where do we find it?
No, that was early. That was in the 60s and 70s, and it got erased by the IRS middle to early 80s.
So EF is inside AAUW?
Yes. I don't remember what the argument was, but the IRS said that AAUW could not have two separate boards.
Okay. I misunderstood you. I thought they said they couldn't be together and they separated them.
They're two separate corporations, Claudia.
Are they still?
They're two separate corporations.
But they don't have separate boards, do they?
No.
That was the big point.
Educational Foundation was set up in Pennsylvania.
Ah.
And so we have to adhere to those Pennsylvania laws, and there was no way to root it out of there and fully ingratiate it into AAUW. So they are two separate entities. And that's why, back to your comment, it will always have a life. It will live on well beyond all of us.
Yep.
So how do we find out about that piece?
It is, it's all documented, but it's sort of like retitled and revamped into the Education and Training Fund. So if you wanted to look at fellowships is that what you're thinking?
Yes, I just.
Campus Action Grants.
If it's in Pennsylvania, it seems like it's out of the way of us.
Yeah, I think there's a 990 that exists for it and it alone.
Okay.
Is that kind of what you're thinking?
Yes. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
The CPA and hers asked, Marty, did you want to add any comments to this discussion? Marty's probably our most recent board member.
Yeah.
It's just amazing how things evolve. And I just want to underscore what you both have been saying as far as our endowments are going to last beyond us because we have been so generous. From the shoulders on which we stand to today's world. And we know we have things that are near and dear to our hearts that we want to contribute to. All of my, if anybody, don't know who'd be interested in this, but all of my giving in the last couple of years, they've really convinced me. I give to the Greatest Needs Fund. I was on the ground with the board as we looked at spending and how to support at the organization as we know it, and the giving that we're doing to Greatest Needs Funds is going to sustain us more than anything else. I'm done.
That's a very good argument. Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Anybody else want to comment on that? And I think I owe an apology. There's an endowment in Margaret's name too, and I don't think I mentioned that. Beaverton was, we got really into this. And so we ended up with several endowments for our members who had been state president. We honored everybody. Okay. Any questions that you have, this sounds strange. I'm going to begin this by saying, as little girls, we are usually told we are supposed to be modest and you're not supposed to brag. And little boys at 7, if they win one basketball game, will say, we are the champs, we are number one. Doesn't matter if they've lost 11 of them. Women are taught not to do that, but I'm going to ask you all to brag. We don't brag about what we do. And the point of this particular session tonight is to find out what you do that works. So I would like you to brag. And that's why I particularly asked Mary, bless her heart, if she would be part of this, because I was, as I said, I was so impressed with the fact that she had donations every single month. So the rest of you, please speak up if you would share. This is a sharing event. I am writing notes like mad, and I will send you a summary briefly tomorrow, because Nancy will, God love her, edit this and put it online and you'll be able to see it. You'll be able to see everything. But in the meantime, anything you ask for, I will send tomorrow. So have at it. Who would like to say something? Who's got a success story they'd like to? Katie Goodwin. Katie, how long have you been the chair in Gresham?
How long have I been the chair? Since 74. Wow. Oh my God. Yeah.
I think you were president of the state at that time or something, or and of course Maryland's
a little later.
I'm Katie Goodman from the Gresham area branch, and
Katie, would you speak up just a little bit, please?
Sorry.
Yeah.
I don't know why my voice doesn't want to carry with this.
Now you're better. Thanks.
Okay. So I've been what I call the advocate for funds and within the Gresham branch, because I've not been in charge of the fundraising as such. That's been other people. But what we've done for a number of years was a brunch auction, Christmas brunch auction. And it's been very successful. It's morphed. We've gone more to silent auction rather than so much open, just because it's a much... The open auction, there were so many items that it was just forever to get stuff to, you know, get it done. And of course, we can do Visa now, which is helpful. People tend to spend a little bit more money when you do Visa this year. And Barb Lintner is with us. If you see her name on the screen there, she took on, she's a new member. She moved here from Illinois and retired children's librarian. And anyway, she took on the fundraising aspect of it, and we've gone virtual, and we've done it. We have had e-blasts go out asking for requests, and we do it's three-pronged, which I know AAUW doesn't like as well, but that's what I've been overruled.
Explain that. What do you mean by three-pronged?
Well, we raise funds for our local scholarship at Mount Hood Community College, and for the Nick Whistle, and for AAUW funds at the same event. Yeah. And this year, I have to say there's been a lot of emphasis on the Mount Hood one, because we're almost to the point of having that endowed. And so the person that's in charge of that has been really working hard. But I know, Claudia, we don't get reports every month from us, and I find out most stuff after the state chair emails me.
Yes.
The people, yes. Because yes. We have, like I mentioned, Marilyn Zook, and we've got Marty and Cynthia Rauscher. We've got several retired state and or branch presidents, and they believe and contribute to AAUW funds very, very well. So my bragging is that I didn't know until I got the information from the state state convention that Gresham was like number one, I believe, in per person, and like number two in total giving this last year.
And surprise!
Yeah, like I say, we've got some, you know, some of us that contribute out of, you know, do the IRA thing, so we don't have to pay taxes on that. And, you know, there's different things that you can do where you contribute and stuff. So, but Barb, the auction this year is going very well. I mean, I think that we're all, the board is all amazed at how much. And so one of the things I did with advertising the virtual one is I said, we don't have to pay for a brunch or a lunch this year. So consider giving at least the amount you would have spent for lunch.
Good idea. You're doing it virtually. Where did you post what was being offered?
It's been mostly online, and then of course people that don't get stuff online get hard copies in the mail, and then the membership committee has been calling people just to keep connected and stuff. And so with that phone call, we've also been thanking those that have already given, and reminding the others that there's still time to donate.
Very good. Hillsborough did an auction also, and we posted it on Facebook, but because it was the first time we'd done it, there were no really good big items donated, but I still think they still raised a couple hundred dollars just from nice little things.
Yeah.
Is anybody else doing an auction like that, a virtual auction? Yeah, Barb, that from Gresham, go ahead.
Yeah, right. I wanted to say ours is donation only. We do not have items on a website or anything else. Ours is just strictly donations. We had a thing called, I mean, the auction was called Calling All Angels, and we just put the forms out with all the different places to donate and send them out by email. We put them in our newsletter. We've, as she said, we've been calling people to remind them about it. So the things we're going to take in are strictly donations.
So it was not really an auction of items.
No, it wasn't this year.
Oh, okay. Okay. Okay.
Just wanted to make that clear.
Yeah, that was not clear to me. That's why I was trying to figure out how you were doing that. Katie had another interesting point. Sometimes you'll have members who donate directly to the national. There are a lot of envelopes that come out asking you to donate to certain things, and members will donate to those, and you as a branch chair may not know about it until you get the quarterly report.
That's right.
Sometimes they'll come in and surprise you. And I want to, somebody has already asked, Susan Shea, bless your heart, asked about her branch named gift honorees. And I said, chances are good that your fourth quarter final report for 2020 won't be available until at least the 1st of February, and it may be later, because Tremaine Parquet does that, and frankly, he is doing four jobs right now. So he's very busy, of course, with the year-end CRFs now, and then he'll be busy with doing all the quarterly reports. If you will look at your third quarter report, which I sent to every branch when it came out, I think I maybe sent it the 1st of November. I'm trying to send you something the 1st of every month. And I think the 1st of November, I sent out the quarterly reports. Look at your bottom line. Go back and look and see if you have any $1,000 donors other than the branch. Does that make sense? When I looked at Lake Oswego, they had $2,000 donations, but they were from the branch. If they're from an individual member, you have to subtract them from your total. Oregon does so well that there was a complaint many years ago that some branches that had big donors were taking all the top awards because they had two or three or four members giving $1,000 or more every year. So the smaller branches ask us to come up with a policy for that. So what we said was, for every $500, you get a named gift honoree for your branch, but from your total, you have to take any donations from an individual of $1,000 or more, and they get their own named gift honoree.
Right.
Any questions about that?
So Susan, you might also want to talk about the little effort that we did for RBG.
Yes, please do.
That was as an example.
Brag a little, please, Susan. That was really cool.
Well, yeah, it was.
Tell them what branch.
Lake Oswego.
Thank you.
It was Pat Squire's brainstorm. I'm the fun chair, but she's the brains. that after, when she died, what we did is, as we had already given, our branch usually gives $1,000 a year to funds, but we did another $1,000 and we challenged our members to match it for not collectively. And so, you know, we just sent out a lot of different emails and things like that, and in the newsletter, and they came through. So in total, I think we raised over like $2,400. $1,000 of that was what the branch gave, but $1,400. Now, to be honest, a lot of the donations were from people who other years have given anyway. So some of that was additional money. Most of our donations are done on the national website. I used to do every other month, and I think it was too often, so I've done it less this year. But we put a form in the newsletter so that it's there, to telling them, you know, how to get to the national website, and it's also there if they want to send a check in. But most people would much rather just pay by credit card. It's just so much faster, and it's a lot easier on our treasurer.
Are they able on that form to credit the Lake Oswego branch?
On the form, if they pay by check, ends up coming to me. So I'm the one who has.
There was a there was a complaint a few years ago that if you sent your money in, which most people did by credit card, if they were donating directly through National, there wasn't a place on the form to credit your branch or to do a tribute or a memorial. And I know on the new one there is, and that's what I was hoping.
If you go into the National website, you have to have your member number. Now, the problem we have is, because I think it came up with one person here, because we have a lot of some members who belong to other branches as well.
Right.
So which branch gets credit for their donation? You know, we're all one group, so we never use all of our name gift honoree. That's never an issue. You'd be out of members in a hurry if you know you did that.
I think they're up to 10 now.
You know, that's not an issue. So
you want it to be more important.
Yeah, we want it to be important and be special. Right. We try to keep it to about a year. So sometimes I have a committee that wants to go more. I mean, I've had committee members one time when they hear it, oh, what do we do? And it's like, you know, you can't do everybody in one year or you're not going to, you know.
You won't have anybody next year.
That's right. And you want to make it special.
Right. So,
yeah.
Okay, any other comments about, are any of you having trouble with members complaining about donating directly? It seems to me the problems that used to be there several years ago are gone now, I'm hoping. Everybody doing okay with those? I'm not seeing any negatives.
Okay. This is Claudia. Yes. Can I do a brag?
Yes, please.
Can I add to your brag? My grand's past groups. I know Suzanne and Georgia are with us. So if I don't have exact figures, so you guys jump in. We do our big fundraisers, our kitchen tour every year. Yes. And we make several thousand dollars with that. And because of COVID, we could not do it. So our fundraising committee send out a plea to every one of our members saying, okay, we cannot do this year. So we need each of you to step up. And they did really, really well with those donations. Our Grants Pass members just stepped up really well from what I understand. And our money is normally shared between National and Rural Community College. Mm-hmm. So we do both. So I don't know, Suzanne, Georgia, do you guys have anything to add? My other Grants Pass peeps?
Well, our timing was such, am I on?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Okay. Our timing was such that everyone that was entitled to get a stimulus check got one. And so we said, aha. So, and a number of us said, well, we've got these stimulus checks. What are we, you know, and do we need the money or so? So that was our timing. And it proved to be very, very successful.
Very clever.
Yeah.
Very good. Oh.
12. And our Grants Pass group steps up. I mean, our endowment, I believe, is funded. Is that correct, Claudia? Uh-huh. Okay. So our Grants Pass endowment is funded.
I'll send you all the list tomorrow.
Okay, perfect. But on a personal note, as far as my personal donations, I have shifted a little bit how I do my own personal donations. I'm now doing part to Greatest Needs Fund, but I'm still doing part to LAF. I can't get that out of my head yet, but I am doing at least half of my personal donations to Greatest Needs. So I'm trying to shift my mindset.
Well, and I don't want to discourage anyone from giving to the fund they like best. The other thing is when you, if you have an honor or a tribute or a memorial listed on your report form, Mary had one on hers that was this strange fund that I didn't know about. Well, there is a place on the card that I send that says what fund it is you've donated to. And people like, for example, I got one the other day and she wanted the one that is the education one because the woman was a teacher for years and the education and training fund just hit her right. So I put the number education and training. So her friend knows that's where the money went that honors her. So think about that too when people are saying, you know, where do I give my money? Well, if you're doing it to honor somebody, where would they like it to go to?
But, and I tagged mine on with Lake Oswego with my Greatest Needs donation. I did it at the same time they were doing the RBG.
Oh.
So I did mine in honor of RBG to follow through on Lake Oswego's coattails.
Good.
Awesome.
And Pat's thanking you up in the corner here.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody else willing to brag? tell us what you've been doing. Betsy, what have you been doing?
Thank you for inviting me to do that, because I was just on the edge of my seat thinking, well, should I say something?
Come on,
or not?
Ashland,
because I'm kind of a newbie. So I'm the funds chair with Ashland Branch, and this is my first year doing the funds chair, but I stepped into it even though I don't see myself as a fundraiser, because I co-chair with Paula Wyken, one of our co-presidents, our upscale sale. For many years, we had a garden tour, and we reached a point where we couldn't seem to make any more than a certain amount from one year to another, and it's a great deal of work. So we evolved into an upscale sale, having various garage sales across town, maybe four or five, and getting the community to come to one sale and then go to other sales. And then that morphed into one upscale sale, which we've had twice every other year basis. And it is really a giant garage sale where we publicize that as an upscale sale, and we ask our members to limit their contributions to things that are upscale. We raised $13,000 two years ago.
Wow.
We held our sale at the Bellevue Grange so that we would have all that space. So it, and remember, we're the largest branch in the state of Oregon. We have been for a long time. And this fundraiser capitalizes on the size of our branch. Because if you have a lot of women, then women, a lot of women have a lot of stuff. Mm-hmm. And so we even have provided storage in the past. There have been lots of challenges, but it's lots of fun. So like some of your other branches who have not been able to fundraise with an event, we haven't because of the virus. So we're pushing our event into the future. But some of those funds are for AAUW funds. But let me tell you this. There's been a stronger desire to contribute to National AAUW in Ashland in the last few years. I've been a member for quite a while, and being on the board, I know this. We have used the five-star program, which we did complete, and just the reorganization of National to help educate our members that National is managed better and has been brought into the 21st century from the way it was managed before the reorganization that Betsy referred to. And so some of us now are excited about the way National is operates and Kim Church's leadership and so forth. So we do a lot of education through our newsletter and emails about that. And in our board meetings, that's where there's been most of the action. Last year, we dedicated $5,000 to National, but the branch did that. Still, our members' contributions are lagging. You know, it's just not been our tradition. But we did do well last year with that $5,000 donation. I was looking here before the meeting. We managed to rank fifth in the state. And if you know Ashland, those of you who have been around the state for a long time, that's not usually, right. We don't usually do that well. So we're coming up, and also we changed, another thing we did is we changed our registration form. When it was time to re-up membership, we looked at the way members could contribute to scholarships. We also, like Grants Pass, I think it was that mentioned, we have a foundation at SOU and RCC. Community College and SOU University. And so members can choose to make contributions then at that time on their form. And we rearranged it so AAUW Greatest Needs was at the top.
Thank you.
We'd been at the bottom of the list. And the membership chair said, why don't we just put that up at the top? The forum's kind of busy as it is. But so things like that, we're juggling around, we're working at it, trying different things. I'm here today to learn and listen and see what we can do to improve. So let's see. I think that's all I have to share, Claudia.
I'd like to back up a little to what Betsy said. They are another of the branches that contribute through a college foundation. And the kitchen tour, I have to say, was when I was on the National Funds Committee for 4 or 5 years, the kitchen tour was one of the things we highlighted, and the garden tour, because they were bringing in so much money. One of the things that came up a couple of times that I'm going to warn you all to be very careful about is that if you are raising funds at an event and you're sending it to two or three different places, if one of those is not, if it's, for example, for your branch budget, you have to have in if everybody can see it, very visible right in front, a statement that the percentage of that is not tax deductible. And the reason this came up so, I mean, they just pounded it into us, because the chair of the funds committee, when I was on it, her best friend is an IRS agent. And she took Diane to lunch. And she said, this would have been, I don't know what, late 80s. She took Diane to lunch and she said, I'm going to tell you something I maybe shouldn't tell you, but we are coming after AAUW. And we are coming after branches that sit on their money or that don't declare what is not tax deductible, because their big thing is donor intent. You have to do what the donor thinks you are doing with their money. And if they think it's all going to AAUW and it's all tax deductible and some of it isn't, you can get into big trouble. You can also, which we haven't had, in the early 80s, Penny and I've talked about this, it was the Hillsborough branch, sat on their funds because they didn't have enough, they didn't have $500 altogether to make a named gift honoree and they wanted one. So they sat on it for a year, didn't send it in. Naughty. And someone turned them into the IRS and it took them 5 years and an outside attorney to get them off their backs. They had not done it with intent. They had done it without realizing what they were doing. You have to send those funds in the year in which they are donated. Mm-hmm. Any questions about that?
No, I understand.
Okay. And I think I've said that in a couple of my emails too. It's one of those things that need to be repeated again and again. Send it in the year the donor gives it. And if what you're collecting is not fully tax deductible, you must have a printed sign that tells them that. Donors have to be told. Okay. What else would you like to say or what would you like to ask? I'm going to send you tomorrow the website, the AAUW website. It's a whole list of things about giving. It includes some of the things we've talked about tonight, but it also includes a bunch of questions. And I told Betsy what was fun about this is that I was part of the group that put this together. And they wanted to know things like the relationship between branches and the college partners. And can a branch newsletter announce an event for another group? And what do you tell branches who say their donors don't really need to know where it goes? They don't really care. One of the examples that's used a lot when people are asking, can AAUW raise money for another group, is the Girl Scouts don't raise money for us. We should not be raising money for another group. So what branches have been doing instead is if somebody stands up and says, my group is raising money for a girls' school in India, we say, if you want to donate to that privately, fine, but we won't do it through the branch. Yeah. Questions about that? Mm-hmm. Anybody come across that one? We had in Beaverton a woman who works very closely for 30 years with schools, the education system in Uganda. And she had one of their national officers here visiting. And it was the same thing. The branch could not donate, but people passed the hat and donated privately. Georgia.
I had an issue brought to me by a branch last year about the branch had a 501c3. Okay. And AAUW was not in the 501c3's name. But the 501c3 said that it was not well known. So it conducted a fundraiser using the branch's name, because the people in the community knew AAUW, but it did not know the 501c3 by the 501c3's name. It had a different name. It did not have AAUW in it. And there were people in the branch who took great umbrage at this use of the branch's name
for raising funds for the 501c3. I mean, there was no misuse of funds at all. I mean, the 501c3 raised money to give out scholarships and everything was above board with that. But there was this problem with using AAUW's name that was a little bit contentious.
Why was their name not part of the 501c3?
Because they set it up as a separate 501c3 without using AAUW in its name.
Are they an affiliate of AAUW, do you know, Georgia?
Nope, was not an affiliate of AAUW. It was a separate 501c3 foundation. Mm-hmm. It was a regular 501c3 and followed the law and all that stuff, but it didn't have AAUW in its name.
Right.
There was also...
Do you know about that, Betsy?
Issue that the 501c3 charged a processing fee, which the branch leadership thought was a little excessive. There was a little contention in that branch. And I'm not going to go talk about which branch that was.
I don't know anything about this. Betsy, do you?
I do have some history on it. Yeah, I do. Yeah. And it kind of loops me back to policy. There are AAUW national policies for fundraising, and it is to protect our status and yes. safety within the IRS structures and its policies 501, 502, and 600. And Claudia has reference to those in the email she's sending, and I won't soft pedal it. They're not the easiest policies to
The reason I bring it up is only because of being careful of usage yes. of the AAUW name. That's all. Right. The only reason I'm bringing this up.
I'm glad you did.
In terms of the use of the money was above board, no problem. Mm-hmm. But using the message that I tried to convey was that AAUW and AAUW of Oregon are very careful about the use of AAUW's name. So be yeah. aware of that.
Okay, thank you. Pat Lehman has, and Pat, your mic is muted.
Were all the board members of that 501c3 AAUW members?
Yeah, and I can talk to you about that privately, but I'm not going any further with that now.
I know.
We were aware of that last year. I think I CC'd you on that information.
Yeah. I just wanted that to be clarified, because I think that does make some difference.
All the members of the 501c3 were also members of the branch.
Okay. Pat Squire, did you have a comment?
Just a quick comment. Our branch has had a relationship with Clackamas Women's Services. And this year we talked with them, and we had another connection with an early childhood program. And our members are given the opportunity to buy gift cards for these families individually, but it's not done through the branch. It's an individual effort for people who want to support these women in need directly, which I think is, Susan cleared that with you, Claudia, but I think actually a perfectly good thing to do.
Yeah, it's a lovely way to do that. And people often are looking for something, some place to give that kind of donation.
Sort of more direct.
Yes.
Yeah, more direct assistance, especially now.
Yes, yes. Anybody else want to say something?
Claudia, I just want to, it's a little bit kind of a different topic, but when Pat Lehman and I went through and talked with all of the branch presidents when we were first coming into office, we did phone consultations with every branch incoming, outgoing president throughout Oregon. One of the things that came to our attention is that by far a good majority of the branches wanted more connection with national, and that included funds. They wanted more knowledge and more connection with national. So I think we're seeing a little bit more of a far-reaching knowledge base in our branches.
Good.
And I'm really, really happy for that, because the borders go beyond our small branch borders. And I think that's one of the things that we really saw in our discussions with our presidents, is that they wanted more knowledge as far as what we are, what we've done, and how national has an impact. So I don't know, I can't speak for Pat, but for myself, I found she's that it's very, very, yeah, she's doing this. Pat and I always do this together. But we found it very, very rewarding that our branch presidents around Oregon wanted to be involved with national. So for me, that was very positive.
That's a good point. Thank you, Sue. That's a really good point. Okay, for those of you who don't have, there are branches that don't have a funds chair listed in the state directory. I'm sending to any funds director that's any funds chair that is listed in the directory. And if there's none listed, I send to the president. Those of you who are funds chairs, do you want me to send it also to your president?
Sure. Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Okay.
And yes.
So I will add them to my email so that now if you get the Katie, for example, shares her when I wrote to her, she shares that and told me the name of their new chair. Just a minute, Margaret, I'll get to you. And so I was able to do that, but I'm not sending it to the president. If you want me to, I will add the president.
Well, yeah, and again, I'm speaking for Pat, I think we would prefer that. We are starting to have meetings with our presidents via Zoom. We hope to do it at least quarterly, if not more often than that.
Okay.
Because we want a whole entire transparent communication level going. That's one of our goals, is to build a team throughout Oregon. So I personally think that would be a great idea. Thank you.
I will start by sending, I've sent three and I number them. I will start by repeating those and send everything out again.
Oh, good.
We'll start all over. Margaret, you had a comment or a question. Margaret?
Yes, I belong to the online branch and we have a huge board. We have a president and a treasurer.
I know.
Our dues are $10 and we meet quarterly. So we don't have much fundraising enthusiasm. We do send donations to our special projects fund for Nick Whistle, and that's about it. So anything, and I see board members of my branch here.
Yes.
And so I guess at our next branch meeting in whenever it is, January or February, we should talk about giving. So anything you could do to help.
You do have members who are giving because I've got a few of the things on the reports. Yeah.
Yes. But, you know, it's, I think I joined the online branch so I wouldn't have to do anything, just listen. So all this stuff I'm getting to do is something else.
Margaret, that's because that's why the rest of us joined the online branch.
That's because your president is very aggressive. She made me say to her in person, I don't have time, Elena, to do anything more than what I'm doing. And she didn't like that response. She's gotcha.
Yeah.
Claudia.
That's all I want to say.
Okay, somebody else had a question.
Mary.
Mary.
My only question is, if you send it to the presidents, would you remind them that the giving list is confidential? That was an issue for me. And I'm really protective of our people.
Yeah. Okay, what I will send, Mary, I would never send that to anyone except the funds chair, unless there is no funds chair, but you're right.
Okay.
I will put on it, this information is not to be shared. I had a member in Beaverton years ago ask me directly how much somebody else gave. That's not ethical. No. You're not to reveal that. What I will include the presidents on is the information that I send out once a month.
Okay.
And there's nothing in that that is personal information for anybody.
Does
that help, Mary?
Yeah, I think that's a good reminder.
Okay, and Susan had a question. Susan, you had something you wanted to say or ask?
No, sorry.
Oh, okay. Pat, I saw a hand over here somewhere. No, I'm seeing things. All right, anything else? I will remind you that I'm going to send out tomorrow the endowments list by branch. Bless you.
Mute. Sorry.
Can you say that you're moving?
Yeah. Yeah, this weekend.
Betsy's moving.
Just a couple miles down the road, but
so I have a feeling the sneezing is from packing boxes. She comes home every night and just packs like mad because they're moving on Saturday. Okay, I will send out the newsletters I've sent out at the first of each month. I will send them to all the funds chairs and all the branch presidents. Pat and Sue, do you want me to include any state officers? So I'll include the two of you. Anything else you'd like me to include?
Oh, sorry, I got distracted. I just got a message that somebody is coming to deliver cookies to my door.
Go get them. Get them.
Hey. I'm going, but I'm going to deal with this. Thank you very much.
I think just to Pat and I, definitely Pat and I, but I don't know that it needs to go out to the rest of the board.
Okay.
That's what I want some of Pat's cookies.
Okay, Nancy, did you want to say something and finish this up? No?
Anybody? No, I just want cookies.
Oh.
Cookies. Thank you, Claudia and Betsy.
Any last comments?
That was awesome.
You, Claudia and Betsy.
Yeah, please really great.
Get in touch with us if you have anything you want to ask. Please get in touch with us if you can brag about something that worked, especially now. We need all the help we can get. So,
Claudia, where's our cheer? You got to cheer for me, girl.
Come on, you lead it, pal. You
lead it. Thank you so much.
Thank you
all. Thanks for participating, everybody. Good night.
Bye-bye.